Picture this. Lego Spider-Man, about to start his day, scales the wall, flips around, shoots his webs and has to realize that most Lego buildings ain't taller than two stories. Not exactly web-swinging material. But don't worry, I'm going to show you how you can create your own Lego building generator in Blender for free, with which you can easily adjust the height, width and much more. Before we can get started in Blender, we need a Lego house.
Pick up the pieces and build a Lego house.
Yes, we could of course build one, but we can also just download one. A good place for this is mecabricks.com. In their library you can find thousands of different Lego models. For what we are planning, however, we're looking for modular buildings in particular. These are these here. There are two different types. Those that have space for neighboring buildings on the left and the right, and those that go around the corner, like this one or this. We'll start with the buildings that are open to the left and right. And it doesn't really matter which of these models you choose. The goal is that what we are building today works with every modular building and that you can easily build your own arsenal. For the tutorial, I'm choosing this custom modular building from Namib. It's not based on a real Lego set, but it still works perfectly with the building generator. It also has this billboard on the side that we can use later. When you've decided on a building, open it in the editor. There are a few things we can prepare that will make our life in Blender easier. For example, we can first delete everything we definitely won't need, like all these lights. I actually have no idea why the spotlight on the floor is still visible, even though all the light sources are gone, but whatever. One advantage of deleting things here in mecabricks instead of doing it in Blender is that in mecabricks many models are nicely organized in a folder structure, and it's much easier to select everything. What can definitely always be deleted is all the minifigs. Then I always adjust the sidewalk on my models. I often delete all the lanterns, mailboxes, trash cans, etc. because I prefer to place them manually later where I want them to be. I also change the color of the sidewalk to a lighter gray because I always use these streets that I built for my cities. And those use a different color scheme with dark gray streets and light gray sidewalks. Another point to make your mind up about is how you want to deal with the interior of your buildings. Most models are also very detailed on the inside. But if we later build a big city in which most of the buildings are only visible in the background, you will never be able to see what is inside. All those Lego bricks just suck up resources, worsen performance and increase render times. That's why I would say it's advisable to make the buildings as empty as possible. Or, as a compromise, at least empty all the upper floors, but leave the ground floor, where most of the shops are located. Because the ground floor is where you can look inside the easiest later, and then it doesn't look strange if the building is completely hollow there. Now that we've emptied our house, there's one last important check that you shouldn't forget. Make sure that the building is completely in the middle. This is already the case for most of the sets, but some, like this one, are slightly moved to the side. We should adjust this so that we don't run into any problems in Blender. Now we can export the set. To do this, we go to File, Export, and select Blender add-on for the format. If you don't have this add-on yet, you can also get it from mecabricks. It's in the shop area. There is a free version and one that costs money. Both work with this tutorial. The version that costs money differs mainly in that the Lego bricks look more realistic because they can have imperfections such as scratches and fingerprints. Now we are finally in Blender and can start with the actual construction of the building generator. I am using Blender version 4.1. At the time of recording this video, this is the latest version that supports the mecabrick add-on. Now let's delete the cube and import the building that we have prepared. This is again a question of performance versus appearance. If we leave logo on starts activated, the models will of course look more realistic. However, it also uses up quite a lot of resources. I have discussed exactly how much in another video of mine if you are interested. I will definitely deactivate the option for this tutorial. Now we have finally imported the building into Blender. First of all, I will deactivate the display of the relationship lines, which can quickly become annoying. If your building is not completely visible, you can set the view distance. Since Lego models in Blender are very large, it is advisable to turn the maximum distance up a lot. However, if the distance between the minimum and the maximum distance is too large, this can result in a deformed display. So find an average where everything looks good. With numpad 1 we can select the front view. Alternatively, you can also click on negative Y up here. To make sure everything works correctly later, the front view of the building should also be visible in the front view in Blender. In this case, we have to select the empty and rotate it minus 90 degrees on the Z-axis to achieve this. Basically, the building generator works in such a way that each building is divided into three elements: the ground floor, the floors, and the roof. Each element gets its own collection in which all the corresponding parts are located. In this particular case, there's also the billboard on the side. As already mentioned, we can use this later, so we put it in its own collection. To do this, we go back to the front view and select all the parts that belong to the billboard. Press M and select New Collection and enter the corresponding name. After that, we can deactivate the collection right away and carry on with the rest. Now, we select everything that belongs to the roof. Depending on the model, this can be easier or more difficult. The fire escape stairs that some buildings have at the back can get particularly difficult to divide up precisely sometimes. And stairs on the inside can also get a bit tricky. If you hold down Shift, you can add more parts to your selection. If you press C, you can get kind of an eraser that sometimes makes it a little bit easier to reach individual parts. A simple click adds parts to the selection, and with Shift click, you can also remove parts again. When you move your selection with G, you can see whether you have got everything. Then simply release with a right click so it snaps right back. As I said, with some buildings it's super easy to split the floors, with others it can be a bit more complicated. So again, create a new collection with M and deactivate it. We will now do this with all three levels until we have a collection for roof, one for floor, and one for ground floor. Or rather, since we eventually want to do the whole thing with lots of different buildings, it makes sense to give the collections a more precise name so that we don't get confused later. Since this model is called Modular Department Store, I add MDS to the name everywhere. I also make sure that all the collections are within the collection that have the name of the building. Always stay organized. The preparations are now complete. Time to save the project if you haven't already. Now we create our building generator. To do this, we first need any object, for example a cube. We will rename it to Building Generator so that we can easily recognize it. In the Modifier tab, we now add geometry nodes. To see them, we need to open a new window and also change it to geometry nodes. To make more space, we can first close this N panel by pressing N. Now we create our node setup by clicking on New and give the whole thing the right name straight away. As you know, always stay organized. A geometry node setup always starts with an input and an output. By default, we have the geometry or our input, the cube, and this goes directly and unchanged into the output. If we cancel the connection by holding down Shift and right click and drawing a line over the connection, the cube disappears because there is no longer any input connected to the output. Alternatively, we can also create a completely new object with geometry nodes. We can add new nodes with Shift A. There is also the cube, for example. If we connect this to the output, we can see it. However, it is not the same cube as before. With this cube, we can now adjust the size and also how many vertices it consists of. To see this, we have to scroll over here a bit and select the wireframe view. With two vertices on each axis, we have a normal cube. With three and more, it is further divided, and if we go down to one, only a single point remains without any depth. Why am I showing you this? Well, let's add an instance on points node. At first, we can't see anything with it, so let's deactivate it briefly with M. The vertices that make up the cube are points. Each corner of the cube is a single point. And with the instance on points node, we can now create a new instance at each of those points. That's exactly what we want. Let's start with the ground floor. We can simply drag the collection in here and then it will appear as a node. And if we now connect instance to instance, we are still way too close and in wireframe mode. Wait a second. Zoom out. Alright, we've now created a ground floor at every point, meaning at every corner of the cube. Since the cube was so small compared to the Lego model, we've now created this clapping monstrosity. If we reduce the vertices to one everywhere, we only have one ground floor. Let's expand the whole thing to the left and the right, so we only select two here. Now we have two ground floors next to each other. If we now increase the size of X, we can place the two instances perfectly next to each other. What we have created here, if I deactivate this node for a moment, is a line of two points that are 256 meters apart on the x-axis. The ground floors now appear at exactly these points. The cool thing is that basically all modular Lego buildings are on the same base plate, which is always the same size. So once we have found the right value, it will work for every other building. We now have the right value for two ground floors next to each other. But if we go up to three vertices, the result still doesn't look the way we would like, because all the additional points currently appear within the 256 meters that we set for the size. So we need to make sure that when we increase this number also increases. And that's not that difficult. First, we need a combined XYZ node, a mass node that is set to multiply, and a value node. With n, we can open the n panel again and give the value node a name. The value that we enter here will be the same as we found out for the size of x. So you can just copy it in here without the m at the end. If we now connect it to the multiply node, enter 1 here and then connect it here, we have the same result as before, right? However, we can now easily set the width using the second value of the multiply node. And the best way to do this is with a separate value node, which we call width. One small visual thing that we can still optimize. Currently, with a value of 1, we have two buildings next to each other. And with 0, we still have one building. It would of course be nicer if the number also reflected the exact number of buildings. To do this, we simply add a math node, which we set to subtract, and subtract 1. The width now fits perfectly. Now we just need to connect the value of the width with the number of vertices. As you can see here, the vertices number has to be always one value higher than the width value. So I add another mass node, set to add, and connect it like this. While editing this video, I realized that I could also have connected it directly to the width node, because now we first subtract 1 and then add 1. But yeah, you can do it either way. And since we don't actually need any decimal values for the width, we can replace the value node with an integer node. Then we don't always have to type in the number, but can simply set it using the arrows on the left and right. Perfect. Now we can easily set the width of our building generator. Just one more thing, if you imagine this building in your Lego city, it is rather impractical that the width changes from the middle like that. It would be better if the first building always stayed in the same place and all the others appeared next to it, right? We can achieve this with a transform geometry node that we place here. We want the position of the x-axis to move further to the right with each increase of the width. So we copy the combined XYZ node because we only want to change the value of the x-axis, depending on the width. So we also need a multiply math node, which we connect like this. The value that has to go at the bottom is the x size. Not the full value, but only half. So we need another multiply node with 0.5 as the factor. That may have looked a bit complicated and I probably didn't explain it very well, but whatever. If you copied everything I did, it should work. We just need to set the width value and everything will work exactly as we would expect. Nice. And that was actually the most complicated part of the whole setup. For the other floors, we can simply copy most of it. You can now tidy things up a bit if you want, and then we can move on. We can now combine this whole part of the node tree into a group. To do this, we select all nodes and press Ctrl plus G. The view then changes to the new group. Here, we should first name everything correctly so as not to lose track. You can exit this group again with this arrow. Here, we now rename the group to ground floor. Oh yes, I also have to rename the new integer node to width. And the group's inputs still need the right names. Select the group and press Tab to open it. The lower value was the width and the upper one was the x size. And we can also call the output ground floor. At this point, we can actually even replace these nodes here and connect them directly to the group input. We can change the type for width from float to integer again. From now on, you no longer have to go into the node tree and change the values there, but you can do this easily in the modifier properties. Quickly copy the old values over and everything works perfectly again. We don't need these anymore. And since we don't just want the building generator with this one LEGO model, but with as many as possible, we can even connect the collection inputs with the group input so that we can easily swap them later. Because that's a great thing about this building generator. Once you've made this effort and everything is set up, it is super easy to create an infinite number of variations. Let's move on to the next floor. With Shift-Control-D, you can duplicate the entire group with its connections. Since the node tree for the floors will look similar but not completely the same, we press the 2 here to make it a separate group and call it Floors. So that we can see what we are doing, we need to connect the group to the output. But since only one geometry can be connected there at a time, we need a join geometry node beforehand to combine the ground floor with the floors. The floors have their own collection, so they also get their own input, which we name accordingly. And then we can select it here. And for a house with only one floor, it works wonderfully straight away. But of course, we want to go even higher. So we need to deal with the vertices Z and the Z value on the combine XYZ node. Like for the width, we can also select two vertices for Z, for the height, and find out the right distance for two floors above each other. 144 looks pretty good. Just like the X size, we can also make the Z size its own input. We can also create a new input here, Z size. And while we're at it, let's create the height and make it an integer type. We can do that with the width here too. We now connect this group input and move it to a suitable location. For the Z size, we can now enter the 144 that we found out earlier. We copy exactly the same nodes that we previously connected with the width and the X values for the height and the Z values. If you make sure that you copy everything carefully, nothing can go wrong. To make sure everything fits, we also have to adjust the Z value on the transform geometry node. So we copy these nodes too and connect them accordingly. And ta-da! Our building generator now works with height and width. Here we can quickly rename the output to floors, and then all that's missing is the roof. This will go very quickly, I promise. To do that, we duplicate the floors group. Make it a separate group again and rename it. Connect it to the join geometry node. Make a separate input for the roof collection and select it. We only ever need one roof. That's why we can delete the whole part that's attached to the Z vertices and set the value to 1. Here we can also remove everything and set the value of Z to 0. All we need is the multiply node, which is connected to the subtract node. So this one can go too. And for that, we now connect the Z size directly to the lower input of this multiply node. I'll just spare you the detailed explanations of why this is the case. Just copy it and it should work. And there it is, our first fully customizable LEGO building. If you like this tutorial, please leave a like and subscribe to the channel, because in the next parts of the series, I will show you how you can refine the building generator even further, with variations on the individual floors, with additional objects such as air conditioning units and also the billboard that we still have sitting in its own collection, right up to lighting, performance optimization, and also how you can transfer the whole thing to corner buildings. And how you can integrate the building generator into your asset browser to easily add it to any project. But until then, you can start preparing buildings with the setup you just made, so that Spider-Man no longer has to be afraid of smashing into the ground. Bye bye!